Hi. Today's video is going to give you information that covers NuTone NM100, NM200, and Music and Sound, or M&S Systems, DMC1 and DMC3-4. The idea for this video came out of a phone conversation I had with a fella a couple weeks ago who was a low voltage kind of installer guy. And he was out on a service call on a Music and Sound DMC1. The customer was having some problems with it, and he called me to see if I could sort of help him while he was there on the spot with what was going on with it. And after talking to them, and he was a good guy and not really experienced that much with intercom systems, but he was trying his best and he seemed very conscientious. But it was clear to me after talking to him for just a little bit, he didn't really know a lot about what he was working on, and some of the controls and things on the system he was unfamiliar with. And the problem that the customer was having was actually something very simple. It was an adjustment related problem. And once I walked him through it, problem was solved. He left, got paid, and everybody was happy. I have talked to many people that have one of those four models, and it's very clear to me that they really don't understand or are not familiar with the controls on their master station. And some of it is important because you can make it appear as if it has problems and you don't know why and you don't know what to do about it because you don't know what all the controls are for. So this is a NuTone NM100, which is a three-wire system, but the controls on all four of those models are the same. So let's go over what each of them does and what you do with them. So this one right now is set up. It's hooked to a power transformer. We're not concerned about remote speakers or anything else like that. This has just to do with the controls on the master station. And so the first thing we're going to do is we're going to turn it on and power it up. And when you do that, the clock comes on, it's blinking 12:04. Why is it 12:04? I don't have any idea, but it is. So the first thing you would do if you need to set the clock is, over here is a button that says time. To set the clock, you push the time button and the hours will flash. And then you use the up and down volume arrows. Volume are these two buttons here to change the time. So it was on 12 a.m. and we want to set it to say 1:30 p.m. So now it's 1 o'clock, and now we need to switch to the minute. So we push the time button again, and you can actually scroll up or down with the arrows. So if we're going to go 30, we can go down to 30 instead of going up to 30. And since I talked for so long, we should set it to 1:31 now. And then we push it again, time another push. And then we can do the set auto on time. These systems have the ability to program a preset radio on time and then a later off time. So this is set the radio on time. So we'll just set this randomly to 5:02 p.m. And then we'll push that. We'll leave it at 2 and we'll push time again. And we want to turn it off at 6:30 p.m. because that's dinner time. And now it's set. So it shows 1:31 p.m., which is what we set it for, I believe. If you do program the auto on and off times, then you have to use the auto button up here. If you push this once, it'll say auto on the display and it will follow those pre-programmed times. So if you want to program it to turn the music on at 5:30 in the morning, you can have it do that and then turn off at 9:30 after everyone's gotten up or whatever works in your house. You have to remember that if you don't want it to follow the preset auto on and off times, you have to turn the auto feature off. And yes, I have had people call me that say, my radio turned on all by itself at 1 o'clock in the morning. Why did it do that? It was because somebody pushed the auto button and it happened to be set for 1 o'clock in the morning, which isn't really what you want. And it did what it was supposed to do. So you have to be aware of that. Once you've preset the time, these models do have a built-in backup power or battery source. So if the electricity goes out, it will back up all the programmed information, the time, the preset radio stations, all of those sort of things. And it will maintain that for about 3 or 4 days. So you don't have to reset everything all the time. If you want to just use the intercom without listening to the music, you can just leave it as it is and use the intercom buttons and that will all work. But if you want to listen to the radio, the first thing you have to do is push the power button. Power button is top right, and it turns the music source on. And right now you can see here it says auxiliary because it's on the auxiliary input. If you don't have any auxiliary devices connected to it, you won't hear anything. And then here, the third button down on the right, it says source, and source switches between the different audio inputs. So we have auxiliary now. If we push it once, it goes to AM. And if we push it again, it goes to FM. And if we push it again, it goes to CD. They did make an optional CD changer for these systems. So if you have that, you would switch it to CD and then play your CDs and you'll hear it through the system. To turn the music off, you push power again and that turns it off. Once you have the radio set to AM or FM, you'll of course want to tune it to your most favorite radio station. So down here on the bottom left-hand column, you have the tuning buttons and you have tune up and tune down. Now the tuners that are in these four models, let's turn this off for a second. The tuners in these four models allow you to tune manually up and down, or you can also tune in what's called a seeking fashion. The tuner in these four models is what's referred to as a seek tuner. There are usually two types of automated tuners on radios. There are scan tuners and there are seek tuners. Scan tuners, which are more common, when you push the button up, it will scan ahead and look for a strong station, stay on that station for a few seconds, and then scan ahead to the next strong station, stay there a few seconds, and it repeats over and over and over again. When you want to make it stop on a station that you like, usually you hit the button once again. Most tuners that are scan tuners will have a single button that just says scan. The tuners in these four models are what are called seek tuners, which means that when you push the button up, it will seek ahead to a higher number, or when you push the down button, it will seek backwards to a lower number. It will find the next strongest station, either up or down on the dial. And once it locks into that station, that's where it stops and it stays. It won't change or look for any other stations until you either push the up or down button again. I'm not sure why they decided to have a seek tuner in these models. It's not nearly as common as scan tuners, but it is what they decided to use. So let's turn this back on. And the volume is very low, and that's deliberate because on these videos, we have copyright issues sometimes with music, and even if it's on the radio, they get worked up over it. So it's on a station right now, but I don't want this station. I want something different. So let's seek ahead and find the next strong station. We'll push the tuning up button, and the display counts and looks, and it's looking, and it stopped at 95.7. And that's some fella yammering on and on about something, and that's not what I want to listen to. So let's push it again and have it seek up. And now we're on 96.5. That's a fairly popular classic rock kind of station with more modern music also. And it's not a bad station, so we'll leave it on there. Now let's say that we like that station. Oh, wait a minute. Maybe you want to go back and listen to the fella who's yammering on and on and on again. Well, we can simply do that by pushing the down tune button, and it will seek backwards. And there's the fella talking and talking and talking. No, we don't want to listen to that. So let's push it back up and go back to our classic rock station, 96.5. Now we like 96.5. It's a good station. We want to listen to it all the time, but I don't have to seek all the time looking for it. Maybe one of the kids put it on 106.5 because that's like grunge music, I think. That's not what we want to listen to, so we want to go back. So let's go ahead and program it as one of our preset radio stations. These four models of intercoms allow you to program in 8 AM and 8 FM presets. So to do that, you have to push the tune up and tune down arrow buttons together at the same time and hold it down, and it will program it into a preset. So I'm gonna go ahead and push these. And you have to hold it down about that long. And now 96.5 is preset into preset number 3. If you use the preset button here, which is the third button down on the left-hand column, if we push this each time, it will advance to the next preset. So there's 4, nothing's programmed. 5 is some random thing. 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, which is 92.3, which is a good station, and 3, and there's our 96.5. So you can preset all of your 8 AM and all of your 8 FM. If you want to access the AM stations, you have to change your source, which is by using the source button. You have to scroll through them. Now we're on CD input, and now we're on auxiliary input, and now we're on AM input. And then if you have preset them, you can use the preset button or use the seek tuner to do that. Let's go back to FM and let's turn this off for a second. I've explained to you now how to set the clock, how to set the auto on and off times, how to turn the auto function on by using the auto button, how to turn the music on by using the power button, how to tune your stations using the tuning buttons, and how to set your presets for AM and FM radio stations. Now we come to the part that's trickier. One of the things about the design of these four models is they tried to keep the appearance of the unit clean and simple. And what you have here are a lot of push buttons. You don't have any knobs that turn or switches that move back and forth. Yes, there are switches behind the door over here for the room control switches, but that's not what we're concerned with today. For the functions of the system, there are no switches that you turn on and off or anything like that. They wanted to keep it all just push buttons and really clean and simple and not clutter it up. And, you know, granted, it's a reasonably nice looking intercom. To overcome the lack of buttons and switches, they decided to make a lot of the system-wide adjustments, things that are usually done with buttons and switches, and put them and make them all electronic adjustments and put them all inside a menu. Now, granted, people hate menus because menus have all of these layers that you have to scroll through to find the thing in the menu that you really want to adjust. And everybody, I'm sure, has had answering machines with menus or copy machines that have menus, and people don't like menus. They get lost in the menu. They're trying to make some simple change or adjustment and they're not sure what they're actually doing, and they get into the wrong part of the menu and they do something wrong and then it doesn't work anymore. So people hate menus. That's a given, but that's what you've got here. So that's what we have to deal with. On the front of the unit, on the right hand column, the second button down says tone. It shouldn't have said tone. It should have said menu, because the tone button is actually the menu button. It accesses the menus for the system-wide adjustments on your system. And this is a big problem with most people, including the fellow I talked to on the phone, because he was unaware of the fact that it had menus and it didn't say menu. So why would he think the tone button would do any of that? It's kind of a design error. So from now on, for the purpose of this video, the tone button will only be referred to as the menu button, because that's what it really is. There are actually two layers of the menu button, or two layers that you can access through the menu button. There are the menus that have to do with system-wide adjustments when the radio is turned off, and then there are more menus that are accessible when the radio is turned on, which just makes it way more complicated. So we're going to do, to access all the full amount of menus available, we're going to turn the radio back on. And we have 96.5. However, I want to switch to 92.3, so I'm going to use my preset button over here and get back to preset number 2. And then we're going to turn the volume down a little bit so I don't have to talk over it so much. So now we have the music playing. So let's go and scroll through the menus by using our all-important menu button. Now, I'm going to forewarn you. One of the errors that was made in this design, and with many, many products that have menus, is if you don't push the buttons quick enough to try to make some change, it will only stay in that menu for a preset amount of time, and then it goes back to the time or whatever. If you're not sure exactly what you're doing, it wants you to be super speedy when you push the buttons, but people are not super speedy because they're not familiar with how this actually works, and it gets rather frustrating. And that's another reason why people hate menus. So if we push it once, we're just going to go through them once first before we go through adjustments. So if you push our menu button once, and remember, I have to go speedy because otherwise it will reset. If you push it once, it says master volume. And it's set to 29. And see how it went back to the time? That's because I was talking instead of pushing buttons. And so it thought, oh, he's all done. I'm gonna go back to the time now. He doesn't wanna be in that menu anymore. So don't you just wanna slap it because it did that? I know I do, I hate it. We'll push it again. Master speaker, master volume, volume of the speaker here in the master. We'll push it again. You have loudness on and off. And we'll go through these in greater detail in a second. We have, see, it went back, it reset again. That's how fast it goes. So we have master volume, now we're back to the time again. See what I mean about it resets all the time and how much people hate that? Okay, and I know it's gonna do it and I still don't like it. So now we have to go faster. Master volume, loudness on and off, treble, bass, intercom volume, music volume, back to master volume. Those are all the menus, and that's pretty much how fast you have to go. So let's talk about each one without pushing the menu button. The first menu is master volume. So this is the master station, and the master station has a speaker. It's right over here. And then you want to clutter up the front of the unit with some knob that you have to turn. That's way all too fashion. What is this, 1945? So they made it an electronic adjustment. When you go to that menu, you use the volume buttons here and you can adjust the volume that comes out of the master station speaker. And it can be adjusted between 0 and 29, 29 being the loudest. The second menu is loudness on and off. So what is loudness? Well, loudness is a circuit that adds more bass into the music that you're listening to. Some people like loudness, some people don't. Purists, audiophiles, they don't like loudness usually. They think it sounds fake. The rest of us think it's really great, especially if you like to listen to, say, classic rock. You know, there's nothing like listening to AC/DC with the loudness on because it makes it more boomy. And we like boomy when you're listening to something like that. Although these systems, not so boomy. Anyway, so you can do loudness on and off. The third adjustment is treble. And we all know what treble is. That's like you would have on a stereo amplifier for your home stereo. And it adjusts the highs of the music that you're listening to. So if you turn it up, you get more highs. If you turn it down, you get less highs. And then the fourth adjustment is bass. And we all know what bass is. Bass is that boomy sound. Not the boomy sound with the loudness on and off. That's the extra boominess. It's just the regular amount of boominess that you get. So if you turn it up, you get more boominess. And if you turn it down, you get less. Then you have the intercom volume. Intercom volume is how loud the voice part of the system is when you're calling to the kids upstairs, say, you kids, knock that off. Okay, that's how loud your voice is going to be when you talk on the system. For most houses, the intercom volume should be set at somewhere around 19, 20, maybe 21. It depends on the acoustics of your house. It depends on how many remote speakers you have throughout the house and all of those sort of things. 19, 20, 21 is a good practical number to set it at. You certainly don't need to set it at maximum, which would be 29. And if you set it too low, if you set it to 5 or 6, then the intercom is going to be too low and it's not going to work very well. And then the last adjustment is what they call music level. And this becomes kind of complicated. On more traditional NuTone intercom systems, you would have a knob, because remember, knobs and switches are better actually than menus. You would have a knob, and that knob would be labeled, and it would be sort of semi-hidden away, behind a door or someplace where it wasn't right out in the open, because it's not something you generally need to adjust all the time. System volume adjusts how much power the amplifier in the master station is going to make, therefore how loud the system is going to be. We're going to go to the menu here, the very last one. It says music volume, it's set to zero. If I raise this up, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and so forth, all the way up. As the numbers went up, we were increasing the power that the amplifier was making to make the music that came out of all the speakers louder. And if you noticed, as I got up above about 22 or 3 or so, the music became very loud and it sounded all distorted because we were making too much power. And that's because right now we're only powering the one speaker here in the master station right here. We don't have this connected to 8 or 9 speakers throughout a house, so you don't need that much power. The basic rule when it comes to amplification adjustments is you want the amplifier to make as little power as it possibly can to give you the amount of sound that you really want. And this is a fine point, but it's a point that gets overlooked, and ultimately in most houses it's wrong. So now we have to go through the menus again a little bit. So we're going to be worried about two possible menu adjustments. The first one, master volume, it's turned up all the way. That's good. Maximum volume is good. On these types of intercom systems, not only the master station, but the volume controls on the remote speakers in the rooms throughout your house, which actually have a knob that you turn because they're more old-fashioned, they all should be set to full to begin with. And I know when you tell that to people, I've done thousands of service calls and thousands of installations, and when you do the demonstration at the end, you explain to people to keep the room speakers turned up to full, and they give you this weird look like, he's out of his mind. What is he talking about? Nothing ever should be turned up to full. No, set it up to full. Set it to 10. If it's got 11, set it to 11, because that's good too. The reason you set the volumes for the master station and the remote speakers to full is then they can use all of the power that the amplifier is going to make. So we know right now that this is set to 29 because you just saw it. And now we're going to scroll through to the last menu, which is the music volume, and we're going to raise it up. Right now it's on 1, and we're going to go 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Fourteen's pretty comfortable. 14's pretty good. Guys like me, we usually like it a little louder than most people, but that's okay. So master volume is now set to 29. The amplifier is set to 14, and we have a nice amount of sound. It's not distorted, and the master station is using all of the power that the amplifier is making. Now I'm going to show you the wrong way to do it. All right, back to the menus. Radio on, master volume. We're going to turn this all the way down. We're going to turn this down to 6. Now the radio is on and the system level was set to 14, but the master is now at 6. And if you listen, you can't hear anything because it's turned down. So now we're going to do what most people would do. Well, there's something wrong. We need to make it louder. So we're going to go back to the music volume and let's crank this baby up. Now we're at 29. Maximum amplification. There's barely enough sound. So now what are we going to do? Well, we'll go back to the master volume and we'll turn it up to 10. Okay? So now you can see, in fact, let's... let's go to 14. Okay. Not quite as loud as when it was the other way. And what I've done is I've set it up exactly backwards of the way it should be. So the way it should be is master station at 29, music level amplification at 14. But now I've made it backwards. We have master station at 14 and amplification level at 29. So what does that mean? Why is that bad? Well, now you have an amplifier that's making all of the power it possibly can. it's just cranking this little heart out there. It's making all the power that it possibly can, that it's designed to make. It's working really hard. It's going to get hot and all of that. And it's sending all that power down the wires to the speaker in the master station, but it's got to go through the volume adjustment in the master, and the volume adjustment is turned down to 14. So it's not quite half. 14 and 14 is 28, it's not 29, but it's close to half. So only half of the power from the amplifier is making it to the speaker in the master station. Otherwise, it would be way loud and way distorted like you heard before. Okay, so you're probably thinking, like most people would think at this point, well, what's the problem? It sounds okay to me and blah, 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 and it's the level that I want. So what difference does it make? Well, it makes a big difference, because if the amplifier is making power of 29 and the speaker in the master is only using power of 14, that means there's 14 or 15 extra power units available that's not being used. So where does that extra power go? Okay, it doesn't disappear. It doesn't evaporate into the ether of the universe. It has to go somewhere, because power doesn't just disappear all on its own. It's got to go somewhere. So where does it go? Well, it turns into heat in the amplifier. And everybody should know that when you use the word heat and amplifier in the same sentence, it's always something bad. So over time, if it's left this way, the amplifier is going to work really, 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 really hard, and it's going to get really, 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 really hot, and after a while, it's going to get really, 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 really blown up. And then you're going to have what is commonly referred to as a blown amplifier. And what's a blown amplifier? Blown amplifier is an amplifier that has this underlying bassy distortion, extra, extra, extra boominess that distorts the sound of the music. And no matter how you play with the menus and make your adjustments, you can't make it go away. And that's a blown amplifier. So remember, what you want is you want your music level, probably in most houses, somewhere around 14 to 16, and you want your master volume set to full 29, as your remote speakers are also throughout your house. Now, I know that was a long way around, and you didn't buy in for all that explanation, but that's what you get, because you need to understand it, because it's important. These sets have a tendency to run hot as they are, because they're in very small wall housings with very poor ventilation, and you don't need to compound the problem by having an amplifier that's running hot purposely, because it's way, way, way misadjusted. So let's see if we can make it through the other menu items, and I'll show you how to adjust them. So we're going to turn this on. We're going to turn the music volume way down because of copyright stuff. And we're going to try to go through these quickly to show you how to do it. So first one's master speaker volume set to 29. That's good. Next one is loudness on and off. To change that, and I'm going to have to keep pushing the buttons to make it stay in that menu. If you push the up button, it turns the loudness on. If you push the down button, it turns it off, and over and over and over and over and over again. The next one is treble, and if you push the up button, the number goes up, and if you push the down button, the number goes down. Me personally, when we have installed these in the past, my go-to treble setting was usually around 12 to 14, and then the next one is bass, same thing. Up button makes the number go up, gives you more bass. Down button makes the number go down, gives you less bass. Again, usually somewhere between 12 and 14. One thing about these adjustments, your loudness, bass, and treble. The speaker cones that are used in this system are fairly small. This is one. This is about 2.5 by not quite 4 inches. They're very small oval speakers. Okay, speakers of this size and this design, they do not like a lot of bass. because it will become distorted and overly boomy again. And especially if you have the loudness turned on, which gives you extra boominess, and then the bass set way high, like to its maximum, and the treble set way low to its minimum, it's going to be overly bassy and it's going to sound distorted and lousy. So adjust accordingly to try to get the best sound out of it that you possibly can. The last menu adjustment will go back again: loudness, treble, bass, intercom volume. Intercom volume is one of those things that I talked about before. Usually somewhere around 19 is good. And if you leave it there, you can just then try the intercom with a helper in the house, talk back and forth, and see if it's loud enough. If not, you can notch it up one or two, maybe a little bit, but that's really all you need. Certainly do not set it just to maximum just because you want it to be as loud as humanly possible. It doesn't need to be that. It should be set thoughtfully so it gives you enough sound but not overdrive the speakers. That's an overview of what the controls on a NuTone NM100, NM200, and Music and Sound, or M&S Systems, DMC1 or DMC3-4 do, and how they work, and why you need to set them up the way you do. I hope you found this interesting, and maybe for someone it will be helpful. If it is, give it a thumbs up. Thumbs up on YouTube, because that helps us just a little bit. There'll be a banner right here that shows you how to subscribe. Go to our YouTube homepage, click on the bell, and when you click on the bell, click on it to receive all notifications. And every time we post a new video, you'll get a notification and you can watch it. That's all for today. See you on the next video.